Hey, I'm Brother Taylor Lindemann, pastor at First Baptist Church in Brooklyn, Mississippi. We're so glad you joined us online today for this sermon. You can find additional sermons at these online sources. I hope that the sermon today speaks to you, and we pray that God will move through it. Point, they made themselves to be no longer under the subject or the rule of King George III. They had decided that now, at that very moment, they were going to be their own independent, self-governing, free nation. And this decision wasn't a light one. In fact, this decision to become their own nation would launch them into the throes of a war for an infant nation versus one of the largest military powers that the world had ever seen up until that point. And yet, this is what the 13 colonies declared. And even though they declared themselves to be free right there, even though they were up against a nation that was much stronger than them, this dream would become reality after a seven-year war where they would be finally, formally recognized as the United States of America. And while the battle for freedom on that day, on that first 4th of July, was fought for so passionately by the young America, today, 4th of July isn't necessarily thought of as passionately as it was in 1776. No, Independence Day for us means hot dogs and hamburgers and picnics and fireworks and friends and all of, maybe for some vacations, all of these different things, a day off. And instead, we kind of put those freedoms that we cherish on the back burner. Freedoms like the freedom of speech, freedoms like the right that we have to gather here this morning, the freedoms that we have laid out not only in that declaration, but in our Bill of Rights and in so many other processes that our legislation has gone through. Instead, it's just a fun day. And it's sad to think that men fought so passionately, so fearlessly for these rights, and today we kind of forget about them to a certain extent. But I think in light of God's Word and in light of today's sermon, I wonder if that forgetfulness is actually necessary. Could it be that the reason Americans have become so forgetful of their past is because the freedom won by militaries, the freedom won by governments, the freedom won so many years ago is but a temporary freedom? Maybe it's because that freedom won by men can never be an eternal freedom. Instead, I think what we're going to see today, as we look at this biblical truth, we're going to find that freedom is found only in Christ. Stand with me as we read John chapter 8, verses 31 through 36. Hear now the words of the living and true God. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, "If ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." They answered him, "We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth forever. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed." Let's pray. Father, we pray that as we look to your word to find the true definition of complete and total eternal freedom, Lord, we pray that you would reveal what that is for us, that you would show us how we might seek after the truth and how this truth might set us free. Lord, I pray that you would convict us of the sin that continues to have bondage over us as a free people. And Lord, I pray that you would teach us that we are sons and daughters of Christ, and that complete freedom is found in you alone. Lord, might your presence be here with us. Might my words not be my own, but yours. And may today we find a truth in your word that we might live out in our daily lives. We thank you for who you are and what you do. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Have you ever found yourself in a lie? A lie that the more you told it, the more out of control it got. And the more out of control it got, the more it seemed that you needed to lie. You know, I've found myself, and I think we've all found ourselves, in a lie or two in our lives that kind of escalated to this point. And, you know, I know for myself, you know, when I'm found in this type of sin of lying, which we try to abstain from now. I'm sanctified and holy now. Amen. But, you know, when we find ourselves in that, we begin to say, okay, who have I told the lie to? Who doesn't know? What does the story need to be? I mean, we begin to construct, what if people find out? I mean, we go into all of these great lengths. Our whole life becomes the lie. I've got to make the lie work. I've got to make sure everybody knows the lie and not the truth. I've got to make sure that it all works out, because if I get found out, it won't be good for me. And that lie begins to consume us. But you know, the funny thing that I found out is that that lie that we continued to tell, that lie that we had to build on and build on and build on and build on, the lie that had once consumed us, that lie, when it's found out, that feeling of being found out, as dreaded as it was for months and years maybe, that is the most freeing moment. To know that the truth is known. To know that I'm no longer a slave to this lie that's so consumed my life. But now I have the freedom to once again live in truth. And that's what we see in our text today, is that truth has a freeing quality to it. Look with me at verses 31 and 32. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. Jesus has been preaching to the people about his identity and his works as Messiah. And you know, there's a lot of people that we see in God's word and in Jesus' life who really deny what Jesus says about himself. They get angry when Jesus begins to speak about himself. But what we see here is that the people are actually following. They're actually believing in what he's saying. If we look back at verse 30, it actually tells us that many believed on Jesus. It's not on the screen, but in your Bibles, you can see in verse 30, it says, as he spake these words, many believed on him. Jesus had just gotten done with this large sermon, and instead of the reaction that he usually got, which was, get out of town, you blasphemer, this time, people believe. This time, people really want to know more about this Jesus. But we see that their belief was not centered in strong faith, because the very first verse of our text, that very last word in the King James, tells us that if they want to be his disciples, indeed. This word indeed is almost like, if you truly want to be my disciple, if you want to be a real, authentic follower of Jesus, you have to do this. You have to continue in my word. And so I don't think these people had strong enough faith, strong enough belief that it resulted in salvation just yet. And I think to continue in Jesus' words, the command he gives to the people here, means both intellectually to understand and to learn God's word, but it also means to live an active life trying to obey in my own life God's word. So it's an intellectual understanding, but it's also an understanding that leads to activity. And so when Jesus tells them, continue in my word, when we talk about word in the Bible, I'm sure the first thing that the Jews come to mind is, continue in my teachings on the only Bible that they had at the time, the Old Testament. And the Jews are sitting there thinking, okay, you want me to continue in the teachings of the Old Testament. But the Old Testament is something that they had already persisted in. Likely, most of the people in this crowd were good enough Jews that they lived a life where they had meditated on, where they had memorized God's word to the extent that they knew the Old Testament. They didn't need to learn or understand it much more than that. There were few who knew better than them. We're Jews. If anybody knows God's word, it's us. The rest of the world, they're lost. They haven't read. They believe in false gods. But us Jews, we know it. And likely, they were even following it, like Pharisees, to the very letter. Not only do they understand God's law, but they tried to follow every commandment to the T. And so these people, when they hear Jesus is saying to continue God's word, they say, we've already done it in their minds. But when Jesus is saying to continue in God's word, continue in my word, that word results in truth. And what we see here is, I think, Jesus kind of enlightening us on this fact that the Old Testament, as important as it is as God's word, truth is given to us in the Old Testament only in part. Truth is given to us in the Old Testament only as a shadow of something to come. But it's in the New Testament. It's in the very sayings of Jesus where he says, follow my word. His interpretation, his following out of that Old Testament understanding. It's only then that we see the whole illuminated truth of God's word as these two are put together. I'll give you an example. We find the story of Isaac and Abraham climbing that mountain for that sacrifice in Genesis. And the rabbis, they probably read that story and they said, look at Abraham, he has so much faith. So much faith that he would almost even kill his own son at God's word. Oh, that I would have the faith of Abraham. And yes, that is a truth from that story. We should want to have such faith that we would be able to do anything for God. That we would go to any length. God, whatever you say, even if it sounds strange to me, I would want to follow after you. But that's not the whole illuminated truth. It's not until the New Testament that we see that Isaac who's carrying the wood on his back, that Isaac who lays down himself, is actually a prototype of none other than Jesus himself. It's not until we look at the cross that we see the shadow of Isaac is really the whole illuminated picture of the Messiah himself. The Old Testament, in almost every verse, is pointing to something bigger, illuminated in the New Testament. And so there's truth in Jesus' words. There's benefits to following after him. And these Jews, they don't know it all. There's more to be understood. And we see as Jesus continues in verse 32, that finding truth in God's word leads us to freedom. Look with me at verse 32. Jesus says, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The intellectual understanding of God's word, coupled with the active obedience in the Christian's life, leads to spiritual freedom. Spiritual freedom because of God's word. Whereas Jesus had told us before that his word gives life, now he's saying, not only does my words give you life, but it gives you even freedom. Freedom. And there is blessing to be had for these Jews in today's text if they were to follow after God's word. And the same is true for us today, that if we were to follow after God's word, there are spiritual blessings to be had. Amen? There are spiritual blessings to be had in the word of God. And one blessing that we receive from God's word is liberation to understand the world around us. God's word reveals truths. God's word reveals truth about who God is. God's word reveals truth about who we are as humans. God's word reveals truth about the world even around us. There is nothing that we understand apart from God's word that when we look deeper into God's word should make the world around us illuminate, that we should see him better because of it. There's example after example of things in God's word that shows us that, wait, I thought I knew a truth about reality, but turns out he's given me more than that. For instance, God's word gives us characteristics of God, that he is holy, that he is righteous, that he is almighty. And on the other hand, God's word tells us who we are. God's word tells us that we are sinners, that we are broken, that we are needy, And when we understand who God is, and when we understand who we are, suddenly the world is a much different place. Suddenly I am no longer sitting on the throne as the most important person on the planet. But instead, now I recognize that there is a God who is greater than me. When I look around at the nature around me, the rest of the world might just see a product of evolution. They might see a purposeless universe. But when we look in God's Word and we see how beautiful His creation is, we suddenly look at that creation and we say, wait a minute, there's more to this than I thought. There is a divine creator behind this who purposed all of this, not randomly, but because He loves me as His creation. Suddenly the world begins to be illuminated around us. And the reality is, the truth that we find in God's Word is the only truth that there is. Apart from God's Word, no truth exists. I was on Facebook this morning, like I am most mornings, and you know, I'm trying to stay away from Facebook. I know most of y'all are in the same boat as me, but I keep telling myself I have to post things for the church. And so that sucks me back in, and that's probably the devil talking. But anyways, I'm on Facebook this morning, and this guy I went to college with was talking about a book he was reading. And the book, I read a little snippet from it, and basically the whole understanding was that your beliefs and my beliefs and their beliefs, they're all, well, that's true to you, and that's true to you, and that's true to you. The whole idea, the premise that it was all founded on was this idea that there is no truth. Truth doesn't exist. There is no truth. So you find your own truth and you follow after it. But what we see in God's Word, and especially here in verses 31 and 32, He's talking about truth. There is such a thing as truth. And the reality is, as we begin to dive deeper into God's Word, we realize that there is no truth apart from God's truth. When we intellectually understand God's Word through study, we are able to fully and freely understand the world around us. And so show yourself to be that Christian follower who is truly, indeed, really authentically following after Jesus. Cling to the words of Christ. Love His commands. Devote yourself to those living words of Jesus. Because too many of us would say that we believe in Jesus, but how many of us go deeper into God's Word than I take you on a given Sunday morning? If you can't go any deeper into God's Word yourself because you feel like you don't need to, because you feel like His words don't have truth for you, that this is all that you need. No, God's Word should open up this well, this thirst within us that we should want to know more and more and more about Him, that we would follow after Him and prove ourselves to be real, authentic, indeed, truly disciples of Him. If you want to be a follower of Christ, seek Him in His Word. Amen? And when you seek Him in His Word, you will be led to experience freedom. And so we see the blessing of continuing in the Word of God is freedom. But we, like the Jews, might say, am I not already free? In response to being told by Jesus that He can set them free, the Jews begin to ask Jesus, what do you mean? Verse 33, they answered Him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? I think the funniest thing about this verse is that Jesus is sitting here telling slaves how they can be freed, and they said, I'm free already. I'm not a slave. And it's so funny because here we're talking to Jews, right? Who their whole history in the Bible, I mean, there's only a snapshot of freedom in the whole thing. I mean, we start off in Exodus, and guess what? They're slaves for 400 years. They've been there, done that. But no, not us. Not the Jews you're talking to today, Jesus. We're not slaves. All right, fast forward. After they're a failed nation because they won't trust in God, what happens? He sends over a tyrant king to just completely destroy them all. And guess what? He takes them over, and most of them, they're slaves. Only a few hundred years before, the people that Jesus is actually talking to, had they actually got freedom. And guess what? The people that Jesus is actually talking to, they're not slaves in chains slaving away for the emperor, but they're being oppressed under Roman rule. They themselves may not be calling themselves slaves, but they're certainly not citizens of the Roman Empire. They don't enjoy the same freedoms that those people around them deserve. And so the fact that he's talking to slaves and telling them how to be free, and then they say, wait, I am already free. What are you talking about? And what the Jews are saying here is not that they're physically free, but they're spiritually free. The reason the Jews believed so certainly that they were free has to do with this phrase, Abraham's seed. Abraham's seed. This phrase refers to the Jewish bloodline, the heritage that they have that goes all the way back to their father, Abraham. And those Jews who stood before Jesus that day, they clung so fast to that ancestry, that heritage, that bloodline, that they almost had this like Jewish supremacy that I'm God's favorite and I'm certainly going to be saved. I don't have anything to worry about spiritually. I am the freest I will ever be because God has chosen Israel as his chosen nation. And so these people, they think they're spiritually free. They think that who their dad is, who their grandpa is, who their lineage is the thing that will save them. Yet the fact they miss is reminded to them by Jesus in verse 34. Look at verse 34. Jesus says to them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. Their slavery wasn't a physical one. They were right in not recognizing the Egyptian slaves, the Babylonian slaves, or even their own oppression under the Romans. Yet and still, though, they were not free men by Abraham's blood either. No, instead, they were slaves to sin. And as slaves to sin, we know that each and every one of us is a slave to sin. And I think, you know, there's a lot of ways that we could show the slavery, the bonds that sin puts us in. But I think we have to stretch it to the max in order to see it very clearly. In all of our lives, we have a family member, a friend, a loved one of some sort who has gone so far into sin's clutches that it's almost, will they ever be able to get out? I think of the addict who, the first time they do whatever drug it is that they're addicted to, they think, you know, I'll never be addicted to this. This will never be the thing that drags me into the clutches of the devil. Yet, that one time leads into another after another after another into full-blown addiction to the point that where they said I would never be enslaved to this thing, now they say this is the only thing that frees me. And then they go deeper and deeper and to the point where the crime of this drug addiction is not the only thing that they have, but instead it becomes lies. Instead it becomes, I'm going to rob people. I'm going to steal from my family members. It becomes, I would even murder for this thing. Sin's clutches is so deep into them, it seems as if they can't escape. That sin has them in its bondage. And just like the addict would be unaware of how deep in sin, how deeply in chains they are to that drug that they're abusing, I think today many of us even may be unaware of the slavery that we're under. I think many of us, like the seed of Abraham, these Jews here, I think if Jesus told us, I can set you free, we might say, you know what? I'm already free. I'm as free as I'll ever be. I'm enjoying freedoms. We might find ourselves in the same way that the Jews said, I'm Abraham's seed. We might say, I'm American. I have as many freedoms as the world could ever give me. I have more rights than any other country. I have all of these individual rights. I've never experienced bondage. I'm in the freest country. I'm the nation who has never been conquered. I am
on this day of all days, this weekend of all weekends, celebrating how we got rid of a mother country who would oppress us. I'm free. But the reality is, while we may have some freedoms in this physical life, as a nation, we're enslaved. And when we begin to look around on a day when we celebrate freedom, and we read that Jesus talks about the sin that enslaves us, look around. How many people today of all days are in church? How many people today in our country have a conviction of what God's Word says and wants to live in obedience to Him? And the reality is, if you're not following after Jesus, if He hasn't broken you out of that bondage, then you're a slave. And our world, by and large, our country, by and large, is enslaved to the passions and the sins that the world has fed them. So many are caught in the grips of sin, and day after day, they slave away and do the work of the devil. They don't know they're slaves. They happily placate sin in their life. They want to do the things that they're not supposed to do. They don't know that they're slaves, but they point to the flag and they say, I'm free in this country. The world doesn't recognize that they can simply put the bottle down. No, they're a slave to it. The world doesn't recognize that Satan has created such a culture of lust, not only in this nation, but in so many, that we would just be entrenched in filthy movies and TV shows, that we would be just so overcome with immodesty through and through in our culture, that we would get to the point where pornography for many men is something that they struggle with and they don't care about. How did we get to this point? Because the world doesn't recognize the sin that they have. They don't recognize gossip and hearsay as slander and libel. No, instead, they see it and they're a slave to it. The world doesn't recognize that their desires are continually evil. Instead, they think, I'm a good person. We're slaves. And just as Abraham couldn't free the Jews, the flag doesn't free us. It may free us in some physical sense. Oh, I am so happy and blessed and thankful for the freedoms that we have in this country. Amen? But I can't stand behind a flag. I can't sing Pledge Allegiance enough times or sing the Star Spangled Banner or do enough of the patriotic things that it would ever save my soul spiritually. Spiritual freedom only comes from Christ. God's Word leads to freedom. Sin enslaves, but true and complete freedom only comes from the cross of Christ. I remember, you know, like many of you, a life I once lived in bondage. Yes, I was saved at the ripe age of 7. You know, really early in my life. So what sins could I remember? But you know, there's been points in my life where as a child of God, I still submitted myself to the slavery of the world. And like many of you, whether it was before conversion or after, many of us have had moments in our life where we found ourselves in the grips of sin. But thanks be to God that by the work of the Holy Spirit in my life, in the lives of so many here today, this is your testimony that God has plucked you out of what type of sin? Out of lust, out of greed, out of hatred, out of whatever sin you struggle with. Speak that truth to the world because God has done an amazing work in you. And that you were once in bondage, but now through conversion, through life in Christ, you have been set totally, completely, undeniably free from the bondage of sin. And as we look at our last two verses, we see that the only place that we can find true freedom is in Christ. Let's look together at verse 35. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abideth forever. Jesus has looked at these Jews and they've said, I'm the seed of Abraham. And Jesus said, No. You're a slave to sin. Really, in verse 34, 34, that word that I'm saying, slave, is really in the King James Version, servant. And those words are interchangeable in the Greek there. And so he says, you're a servant, you're a slave to sin. And so Jesus told the people that they are servants, they're slaves of sin in verse 34. And now he goes on almost to present like a parable. And he says, the servant does not abide in the house forever. And when Jesus begins to talk about the house, about his Father's house, about the kingdom of God, all of these things are linked together. What he's really talking about is heaven. And what he's saying is, the slave does not live in his master's quarters. No, the slave does not abide in the house except for the times in which he would labor. And so the slave, the servant of sin, that person cannot come into God's house. And if a person cannot come into God's house, into his heavenly presence, into his divine abode, then that person ultimately leads to hell. And the reality of sin is that it does not lead to heavenly freedom. Instead, it leads to eternal bondage in hell. We might be free physically in a sense right now, but if you're a slave to sin, the reality is there is a day coming when that slavery will march you right through the gates of hell. And you will still be eternally bound by sin forever. But more than that, the physical freedoms that you experience by the grace of God today will be taken from you for eternity. That you would be a bondservant, that you would be a slave of sin, of the devil, of hell for all eternity. And however, he says in the same verse, but the Son abides forever. But the Son abides forever. And I want you to see the picture that he's painting here, because Jesus has said the slave is outside of the house. But who's in the house? The Son. Well, who's the Son? Jesus. He didn't say the friends of the Son. He didn't say the children of the... He said the Son. Only the Son. And in my King James Version, I think that's a capital S. I mean, what Son are we talking about here? We're talking about Jesus. He paints this picture of in his Father's house, the servants are outside. The servants of sin, of the devil, are outside. And the only person inside is himself. And so now we, like the Jews here, we're Abraham's seed. We're going to, they would call heaven Abraham's bosom. That's how much they waited and loved Abraham. They thought it would take him to heaven. And they said, we're Abraham's seed. We're going to Abraham's bosom. We're going to heaven. And Jesus says, no. The servants of sin, which you are, go outside. And only the Son is in the Father's house. And so we ought to all stop and say, wait a minute. Well, then how do we get to heaven? How do I get to the Father's house? How do I get inside that place where he is? And in verse 36, we get an answer. Verse 36 says, if the Son, therefore, shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. In order to enter into God's eternal home, the Son has to make us free. And if we go back to 34, we see that sin makes us a slave. And in verse 35, we see that sinners, servants of sin, go to hell. But if we go back to verse 31 and 32, we see what it takes to be a free man. Verses 31 and 32, where we started it all off, says, then Jesus said to those Jews which believed on him, they believed, but it wasn't a strong enough faith to save their soul. He said to them, if you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And we see by Jesus' words, not preached here in John chapter 8 in our section that we've looked at today, but in the totality of Jesus' words, we see that the teaching is beyond clear. That the way to heaven is paved by the blood of Jesus Christ. That if we want to be a free man, that if we want to go to the Father's house, then we have to trust and believe on only the person who can save, Jesus Christ. It is through believing on Him and His words that He has made a way for us to get to heaven. And so today, if you don't know Him, my message to you is cling to His words because they're life-giving. Hold fast to His promises because they're eternal. Trust in His work because it is the only work that can get us and free us. And today, church, my call is to turn to Christ, the only one who can give us true and complete freedom. And so today, as Cliff comes, we're celebrating this weekend the earthly freedoms we enjoy as a citizen of the United States. But there's a greater freedom. There's a greater, truer freedom for all who would trust in Christ. And it isn't through heritage. It isn't through a flag. But it is through the precious blood of Jesus that this freedom was won. He who lived a sinless life. He who climbed up on a cross, who was innocent and bore the sins of the world. He who was victorious over sin and over death, that's the one who has freed us. He has freed us from sin. He has freed us from death. And He has freed us to eternal life in heaven with Him. And so today, if you don't know that freedom, believe on Jesus Christ. Repent of your sins, and the truth will set you free. I'm so thankful for the freedoms that I have as a citizen of this nation. But more than that, I look forward to a day when I am a citizen in a heavenly nation where I can experience freedoms that are so real, that are so tangible, that are I'm so taking advantage of that without those freedoms, I couldn't do a single thing. And so today, my invitation is that if you don't know Jesus today, if you don't know the freedom that's found in Him, let today be the day of salvation. Thank you for joining us online today. Remember, you can find additional videos at these online locations. If you would like to give, you can mail your offering to First Baptist Church Brooklyn at P.O. Box 340 in Brooklyn, Mississippi 39425. If you would like to talk to someone, you can call our church number or you can visit us for one of our in-person worship times. We hope to see you soon.
Mm-hmm.